everybody's heard about the bird. The bird, bird, bird. The bird's a winner. Well, the bird, bird, bird. The bird is a winner. Well, the bird, bird, bird. Well, the bird is a winner. Well, the bird, bird, bird. The bird's a winner. Well, the bird, bird, bird. Well, the bird is a winner. Well, the bird, bird. The bird's a winner. Well, the bird, bird, bird. The bird's a winner. Well, the bird, bird, bird. Well, the bird is a winner. Well, the bird, bird. The bird's a winner. Well, don't you know about the bird? Well, everybody knows that the bird is a winner.
Hi everyone, and welcome to Naturalist Nights. My name is Holly Kistner, and I am a naturalist here at ACES. This speaker series is a joint presentation of the Wilderness Workshop, Aspen Center for Environmental Studies, and the Roaring Fork Audubon. Particular thanks to the Roaring Fork Audubon for inviting Dr. Marzluff to join us and Francine for hosting him. Our talks are held each week through mid-March on Wednesdays in Carbondale at 5:30 and on Thursdays here at ACES at 7 p.m. The Naturalist Nights are sponsored by the awesome organizations here on the screen behind me, but special recognition to tonight's featured sponsor, Bristlecone Mountain Sports. We are so grateful to these businesses whose donations cover the travel expenses for our speakers and the cost of having grassroots TV video the presentations. They are what make Naturalist Nights possible. Grassroots TV airs these presentations on Channel 12 Up Valley and Channel 82 Down Valley. The videos will also be available on our organization's website in the coming weeks. And just a heads up about next week's presentation, it will be Jeff Lucas's Warmer But To What End? The Past, Present, and Future of the Roaring Fork Valley. And so we hope you can join us next week as well. But without further ado, I'm really happy to introduce Dr. John Marzluff. I'm particularly excited because I am what they call an aspiring bird nerd. So before I moved to Aspen, I worked in Costa Rica as a naturalist intern. And part of my job was leading birding tours. And about a year ago, I had never noticed, recognized, or thought about birds ever before in my life. I probably wouldn't have even been able to recognize a robin. And suddenly I was supposed to be an authority on looking and identifying birds. So the chaos of this responsibility was compounded also by waking up at 6 a.m., because that's when birds are most active. So waking up with the sun, I was not thrilled at all. So I spent a couple days following around really passionate, observant bird folks around the rainforest, trying to learn the bird species. And they could identify birds before I could even find them in my binoculars. They could recognize a bird call faster than a teenage girl can recognize a Justin Bieber song. And I got really discouraged really quickly. So the moment that I realized I loved this was I asked a friend of mine to just go out, just me and her, and take it really slow and look for birds with me and teach me and help me. And so we woke up at the dreaded 6 a.m. and walked around for hours. And we were just looking and listening, and believe it or not, I was really enjoying it. And then I saw it. A keel-billed toucan flew over the road in front of me. And then I saw another one. And another one, and 8 keel-billed toucans followed each other across the road, flying over my head. And this was such a special and surreal moment for me, a bird that I'd only seen on Fruit Loop boxes before. And, well, needless to say, I was absolutely hooked, and I started waking up at the crack of dawn nearly every day and heading out to bird, even for my own personal enjoyment. And then when I came home to the United States, I started really noticing what was around me, and my appreciation for all the incredible birds that I share a home with really grew. And that's why I'm so excited to introduce Dr. John Marzluff. John Marzluff is a James W. Ridgway Professor of Wildlife Science at the University of Washington. And there he teaches classes about really cool things like ornithology, urban ecology, conservation, field research. He has written a bunch of interesting books, such as In the Company of Crows and Ravens, Dog Days, Raven Nights, which he wrote with his wife, Colleen, and The Gifts of the Crow. He is a fellow of the American Ornithologist Union. So please give it up for Dr. Marzluff.
Thank you very much, and thanks much for inviting me here and for hosting me. It's been fabulous. I've gotten to see all the highlights of the valley, both ends of it, I think, at this point, and I've really enjoyed the time here. So hopefully the snow won't pile up too deep for my plane to take off tomorrow, and we'll be all set. All right, let me switch presentations here. Yes, we're going to talk about bears tonight. No. That's just one of my favorite places. Even when you're a bird nerd, it's nice to look at mammals every once in a while. So what I want to talk about tonight with you all is this book, Welcome to Subirdia. And it's a summary, basically, of research that my grad students and I have done over the last about 15 years, studying how birds have responded to settlement outside of Seattle. It's relevant to the sort of settlement patterns that are occurring here as well, and really around the world, as we've become much more of an urban species ourselves. And it's interesting to try to understand how the other animals around us are reacting to that settlement pattern. And I also want to introduce an artist to you tonight, Jack DeLapp. Jack drew the drawing of these Buick's wrens in the mailbox that you see here. And although he didn't draw the mailbox, that's a photograph, he drew the birds in the box. And you'll see lots of his black and white images from the book throughout the presentation tonight. It was great that we started off with a little bit about Costa Rica before, because I always like to start with this slide. Very common animal in your backyards here, I'm sure. It's in all the Seattle yards. This is a Baird's tapir. It's not an animal you will find in your backyard. And I'm going to talk a lot about those that we do find in our backyard today. But I want to emphasize that the reason for really getting engaged with those common animals is to build appreciation and an ethic to conserve animals like this tapir, which in Costa Rica requires huge set-asides of land where there are no people. This is from Corcovado National Park there. And in that park, people were actually evicted from the park so that we could establish it for wildlife like this tapir, which is tasty and slow and would not fare well with many people around. So that's the kind of end game here, is to enjoy what's going on around us, to build a broader ethic, to value places like this that you may never get to, or animals like this that you may never see. This is a little more familiar scene to any of you who've flown around the region. It might not be as dense of a treed forest here as it is in the Seattle area, but this modification of the landscape where new roads are being built, new houses punched in to whatever the natural background is. Maybe it's sage and aspen and mixed conifer here. Where I live, it's this 60 to 80 year old kind of second growth of Doug fir and western hemlock and cedar that is forms a large canopy across areas to the east and around the Seattle metropolitan area. And when I moved there about 20 years ago, I was interested in these new developments and how they might be affecting the birds in particular that were there. And so we started a long-term study, and with many grad students over the years, we've gone out to places like this and stood and counted birds. How many of you have participated in some sort of a standardized bird count? Yeah, so maybe Christmas bird count or point counts that we do different places or vocal surveys like we were hearing about. But you go and stand at a fixed spot, count everything you hear and see within some distance. For us, it's 50 meters that we get. And we did this all along from Seattle through places like these new suburbs to forested areas further out that are watershed reserves. And when we plotted the number of species that we heard or saw at those different places, as a function of how much forest was around those places, we got kind of an interesting relationship. And it looked like this. So here's the number of different bird species or richness plotted as a function of how much forest is around those points where we stood and counted. From places here where there's no forest, like in Seattle and Bellevue and other small towns that you might be familiar with, on out to some of these reserved areas that again, function to buffer the water resources of Seattle and other towns. And what we see is that as you increase the amount of forest around those points, you get more and more diversity of birds, up to a point. Because if you go too far and you get to all forested areas, diversity drops again. And you get actually fewer kinds of birds there, not as few as in the city, but a lot fewer than in the suburbs. So that's why we call this area in the middle, where there's a mix of built and non-built areas, Subirdia. And that's really these single family housing units that are being developed all over the Puget Sound area. These are rich in diversity of birds. It seems a little contrary, especially to a conservation biologist, but they're rich in birds because they're rich in habitat. So it's not just forest, it's forest and field and water retention areas and golf courses and houses and all sorts of different land covers that each support some different sorts of birds. So we get higher diversity there than we do even in the all forested places. It's not the same group of birds that occurs everywhere along here. It's a very different group that occurs in the city than occurs in the forest, and it's a mix of those groups that occurs in the middle. So just to reiterate, we see higher diversity, but a completely different community of birds as you go from the city to the forest. And you'd see the same thing here. The birds we see, we just classify them into groups along that curve. And I'll talk about avoiders first, and then some that do better around us. As you might expect, avoiders are species that avoid us. They're the ones that would have been found over here on that curve where it's mostly forest. For you all here would be things like, do you have yellow-billed cuckoos?
No?
Well, that's because they avoid areas like this. But you do have Wilson's warblers, and Wilson's warblers are an avoider. For us, the black-throated gray warbler is an avoider of human activity. The hairy woodpecker even, which is a bird familiar to us all. It'll come to your feeder. I saw it at Francine's feeder yesterday. But that's an avoider. As you remove forest, that bird becomes very rare. And it will utilize yards and places where we're at, but not to the extent that it utilizes aspen forests and other sorts of more wild places. There's another group of birds that's kind of in the middle of that curve that adapts to our presence. They do very well with us, but that's because they're typically generalist or kind of early successional species, ones that are in younger forests or disturbed areas. So things like the black-billed magpie that you're familiar with here, that's a classic adapter. They love open ranchland country. They utilize human resources there, but they also need the forested components to nest in. A lot of the chickadees, the great tit in Europe, but chickadees here, the white-crowned sparrow is a species in the Puget Sound region especially that is typically more in the high alpine. You'd be used to seeing them breeding here, but as we open up forested areas, they then breed down around people because it's more like the habitat they're used to. Cardinals in the Midwest. The goshawk pictured there is an interesting adapter. Around here, it is definitely not an adapter. In the U.S., it is an avoider. And we find it in more forested reserved areas. But in Europe, it's an adapter. And that's because it's exploited and persecuted outside of the city. So where you find them in Europe are in the big parks in Berlin and Prague and all the other big cities, Warsaw and places like that. You don't see them in the countryside because they've been shot out there. The final group we call exploiters, and these are the ones that really specialize on taking advantage of people. And they'd be the ones found in the core of the city on the curve over here. They are things that often have house or barn in their name, like barn owl or house finch. And they are things that are non-native to areas often that live in the city, like lots of parrots all over. I saw these ringed parakeets in London a few months ago, and it's like crazy to see parrots flying around London. But there they were, doing great. And then all kinds of crows, your American crows here or hooded crows in Europe are typical exploiters. So we've got a rich diversity of birds, different groups of birds, a changing community of birds around where we live. But we also have all the ecological interactions of species in these suburban settings and urban settings as well. So we've got predators and prey, goshawks and kestrels coming in, preying upon mice and small birds in our yards. We've got parasites and hosts, cowbirds, for example, parasitizing warblers and things like that in our neighborhoods. And then we have facilitators. And I want to call out especially the facilitation that's done by woodpeckers like this red-breasted sapsucker especially, Because not only do they drill holes to breed in and roost in, which then bluebirds and chickadees and swallows all use, they facilitate their presence. Sapsuckers in particular also drill these little sap wells in trees. We saw a lot of these up by Ashcroft today in the aspen groves there. And these sap wells are very important in facilitating insects which utilize the sap, which the sapsucker also then eats some of. But all sorts of insects and butterflies use those. Squirrels will come up and eat the sap. Lots of different animals have their activities and their resources provided by the actions of this little bird. So that's a very important in building a diverse community to have some of these sorts of facilitators. There's another facilitator in this environment, and that's every one of you that puts out a bird feeder. Like on the West Coast, the Anna's hummingbird pictured here has increased in abundance from California up north. It now breeds and winters up through British Columbia. Here's one in my backyard last year. They have no trouble with snow. They're a pretty big hummingbirds. They're big. They go into torpor in the evenings when it's cold. They eat insects as well as nectar. But not only climate change, but the things we've planted in our yard that bloom year round, and especially the feeders we put out, have allowed this animal, facilitated its move north. And now it's a favorite bird in people's yards throughout the West Coast. Some other very interesting and facilitated reactions basically in this environment. And this is an example of a woman who basically organizes her day around going out and feeding crows every day. She walks a set route, she carries food, she whistles, she shakes the bag of food, the crows follow her. They'll walk behind her like a dog, they'll fly over, land in front of her, they'll call to her. They will get her attention, so she gives them the food that she's been carrying for them. And you can see just by the posture and positioning, these birds are very attentive to her and she's very attentive to them. They're very much like wild colleagues that she has out there. Well, I'm gonna take a bit of diversion and tell you a little bit about some of the crow work we've done, because we've tried to understand how these birds react to these particular people like this. And next we'll start trying to figure out how people react to the crows, but for right now, we'll focus on the crows.
Easier to understand.
They're a little easier to understand. There's certainly less concern in understanding them. So we've done some tricks with our crows. We tried to understand, do they actually recognize individual people on our campus? And the way we did this is that we wore this crazy mask as we captured some birds. And the way we catch them is we lure them in with food, and as they're eating on the ground, we fire a net launcher, a cannon basically, a gun that shoots a net over them and pins the birds to the ground. It's a scary event, and it's noisy. It's like a hunting rifle going off. And those birds, when they're trapped under there, then we'd run up to get them out and weigh them and measure them and band them while we wore that mask, so that as they were having this assault on them, they saw that face. And then we let them go. And the idea was we would then walk around our campus and wear that mask and compare the response of the birds when they saw us wearing that mask versus when they saw us wearing this mask, which was our control. So remember now, the bad guy was the caveman. Dick Cheney was a good guy in this respect. And what we found is that the crows were very responsive to those two different stimuli. So before we did any trapping, we walked around without any mask on, with the Cheney mask or with the caveman in a hat, and we didn't see any response in the crows. After we caught 7 birds, they still didn't respond if we wore no mask. And they responded a little bit to Cheney, but they responded a whole lot to the caveman. And that's whether we wore it with the hat, which is actually what we trapped them with, or just the mask, or just the hat, or even the mask upside down. And by respond, I mean they attacked us. They dive at us, they scold us, they chase us, much like they go after, maybe you've seen them go after an eagle or a hawk or a coyote or something. They're getting a predator out of their territory. And they've done that. And the interesting thing with this response to the upside down face is that people, when you're very young, you don't respond very well to inverted faces. You don't recognize that as your mother, for example. But crows and other birds now we know are able to recognize that. They can invert images in their brain to tell what that person is or what that stimulus is, which makes some sense because sometimes they're above and sometimes they're below pieces of their environment. The other thing that still blows me away is that These birds continue to do this and recognize this guy now for 10 years. So we caught 7 birds in 2006, and the proportion of the birds that attack us as we walk around campus with that mask on has increased steadily for 10 years. And this has basically evolved what I call a culture of hate on our campus for that particular guy. At this point, 10 years later, almost all the birds that are responding to us weren't even alive when we captured 7 birds 10 years ago. And certainly there's only, we know of 2 birds, and one of them actually, I just got an email about a few days ago, has died. Only one bird now that we know is alive that we actually handled and captured. The others all either might have seen the thing happen here in the early years or have just heard about it hearsay and take on face value that this guy is bad for some reason. They have no idea why, but he's bad, and they continue to scold us. We've brought these birds into the lab and tried to understand where in their brain this sort of activity is controlled. And first off, we use what's called PET imaging. Some of you may have had that done on parts of your body. If you had an injury, for example, here's a PET image of a crow's brain at work. Here are its eyes. And just notice in a bird, their eyes are really big relative to their brain. You only see a small part of the eye here from the outside, but behind that is a big sensor. And here's the brain. There are 2 hemispheres, just like in yours, a right and a left. And these bright areas indicate activity in visually processing their environment. This bird is actively looking out at something of interest. These images over here just show some statistical results of groups of birds, differences in the groups of birds that saw one thing versus something else. So in this top row, and this is the front, the middle, and the back of the crow's brain, the bright yellow area here indicates that the birds that looked out and saw the person that had captured them were more active in this part of their brain than the birds that looked out and saw nothing in the room. And that part of the brain is the amygdala, and it's the right hemisphere of the bird's amygdala. And if you had been put in an experiment to look out and see something that you learned was dangerous, and then we imaged your brain, your right hemisphere amygdala would also be activated. It's the exact same part of the brain in the crow as it is in us and other vertebrates that have been tested, that is used to remember these learned fears. In contrast, we did some experiments where we let the birds look at not the person who captured them, but look at the person that had been taking care of them, feeding them, cleaning their cages in captivity. We keep them for a month or so before we're done with our experiment and we can let them go. And in those birds, a different part of the brain, not the amygdala, that wasn't bright yellow, but this part, which is the reward center of the brain, indicating that they were anticipating some kind of food reward when they saw that face. So they've learned just in a few weeks to distinguish between a dangerous person and a friendly person. And this is the sort of brain response that Pavlov's dog would have had when he heard the bell go off, right? Anticipating his food bowl coming out. Excuse me. And it's also then what we expect is going on in the crow's brain when they saw that woman and they were staring in the picture I started this diversion with, that they were anticipating that she was going to provide food for them. So they'd already formed a memory of her face, and they know her daily routine, and they follow around and take advantage of that. Excuse me. So I'm going to return now to some basic community responses of the birds to development that we've been studying. And I'll talk about 3 different kinds of places. Some reserves, those watershed reserves I mentioned in the far right of that first curve. Some areas that are already developed, they're regular subdivisions, and we looked at the green space within those subdivisions. And then other areas which we call developing or changing sites. And these are places where, when we started the study, my first PhD student in this project would go around and look for white signs that are posted in Seattle. And you probably have a similar kind of sign. It goes up indicating that there's going to be some sort of activity here, some change in the landscape. And if you are concerned about it, go talk to the Planning Commission about it, right? Well, when we saw those, we quick got in there and started counting birds at particular places. And then we continued to count them over the next 12 years as development occurred. So counting birds here next to this ongoing development, which then spread over that area, we could determine how the abundance and survivorship and movement of birds changed as development occurred. Sometimes we had to wear hard hats and reflective jackets to do that work. But it was fun. And we saw things like this, that just to think about from a bird's perspective, how do you handle this? One year, this is your territory, these pictures. Maybe you're a flicker that lived in that snag, which one did, or a song sparrow in the undergrowth here. And then a few years later, your place looks like this. Same place, this case 9 years later, but the change occurs in about a 2 year period. What do you do if you're a bird who lives down there? Do you stay? Do you go to a new place? Do you die? How do you react? That was the sort of question we were trying to get at with this study. So first off, what we found with respect to just abundance, when we counted the birds that occurred there, we saw great changes in the community composition, just like we saw along that curve in space, we saw it in time in those changing developments. So for example, the Pacific wren, it's one of our most common birds in the forests around around the West. You have them here in the forests as well. And what happens to these birds is that as development occurs, their abundance declines. It drops from what you would expect in a forest to what we saw in a subdivision, which is very few of these avoiders. And in contrast, the junco, which is an adapter, their abundance increased dramatically over that 12-year period from being quite rare, which they are typically in the forest, to being extremely common like they are in a suburb. We banded thousands of individuals and followed them throughout their lives. How many of you have banded birds? Quite a few, great. So, you know, we put these tags on. It's like a social security number for a bird. Every bird there's only one number for that particular kind of bird. And if somebody finds it, they can report that to the federal government. We'll find out about it. We also put color bands on so we can identify them just looking with our binoculars and keep track of who's where and how long they've lived and how many young they produce. This towhee is a good example. This was a bird that lived for at least 9 years. Although the area around him was changing dramatically as a new subdivision was being built. Lived for 9 years, he had three different mates, he produced seven broods of kids, three of which at least survived 1 year. So he was a super towhee, really productive, and didn't care at all about the development that was happening there. It was not uncommon for a lot of these birds, even those small Pacific wrens, to live 6 years. And you would have the same birds in the same territory. So if you've got a robin or you've got towhees or song sparrows or juncos in your yard, they're the same birds every year that are there. They're staking out their space right along with yours. We followed their reproduction. We found that overall nesting success was equal. It didn't matter if you were a bird nesting in a reserve or a subdivision or in that transition from reserve to subdivision. They had the same nesting success. What differed there was whether you nested in a cavity like a chickadee or in the open like a robin. And cavity nesters have much higher breeding success than non-cavity nesters, which has been found everywhere. But it also occurs in the suburbs. The baby robin shown here illustrates the point that we put radio transmitters on these young birds and we follow them around for their first month or so of life. That's as long as the batteries last. And this little robin moved a kilometer in his first day out of the nest, following his parents to a little riparian area. Couldn't fly, he's just kind of hopping and fluttering along. And what we found is actually we expected survivorship of these young birds to be low. It was extremely high. We had very few ever die of towhees and juncos and song sparrows and robins. And the typical response was that they would beeline it to somebody's feeder and they would stay there and they would eat there for the second part of their summer season. And their survivorship was great. What we did see is some active movement of birds in response to development. This was a question I had as a kid. I remember where I grew up in Kansas, there was a subdivision going on in the back part down the street from where I lived. And my dad, I asked him, what's gonna happen to the deer there? Because I was interested in deer at that point. And he said, oh, they'll be okay. They'll move, they'll find another place to live, right? Well, he didn't really know, but it was a good answer for me at that time. And I thought, now with these birds that are banded and we can see the landscape change, we can actually answer that question. Do they move? Do they find someplace else to go? And some do. For example, this Pacific wren, he's number 22408-4237. It's a great little bird. He was breeding in an all-forested area in 2002, and in 2003, he lost about a third of the forest in his territory. The circle represents his territory. We did not find him in 2004. We know he wasn't there, but we didn't know where he was. In 2005, we did finally find him, and he was in a place that was all forest again. So he moved, just like my dad said, and he went 647 meters to find this forested place. So for a bird that big, that weighs a few grams, that's a heck of a travel. What we've learned since, we've analyzed some of the data and we found out that although he made this move successfully, it wasn't really on his terms. And what we discovered was that when a species like the Pacific wren or the Swainson's thrush, that's the other avoider that we studied a lot, when they fail in a all-forested reserve, they will typically divorce their mate, they'll move, they'll get a new mate, and their reproduction will go up in response to that adjustment, that adaptation that they do. When we force them to move, they also divorce their mates, they end up in a new forested place, and their reproduction goes down. So when we force them to make that that change, they don't do so well. When they do it on their own for reasons that, you know, are to increase success, they actually come out pretty well doing that. So that's a detriment, basically, of this change for these avoiders, and one of the reasons that they tend to drop out of those developed areas. They can't make these adaptive sorts of changes anymore. In contrast, birds like the song sparrow or spotted towhee, they don't care. They don't move when that development occurs. They just stay right there and take it. So this is a bird in 2005, his territory looked like this. And in 2006, he was in the same place, even though he had lost that chunk of forest up there to this new cul-de-sac that was being put in. And he stayed right there, reproduced fine in both situations, even maintained his mate in this particular case. And this is what we found of these adapters, is that they basically wait it out and adapt to whatever comes their way, unlike the avoiders. So we have neat ecology, neat sorts of interactions that are occurring in these different subdivisions, these places that we call home. We also have evolution occurring right in our backyards. So I want to tell you a few stories of that now. And the first one features the Brewer's blackbird. How many of you all know Brewer's blackbirds around here? Yeah. So it's a pretty common bird. For us in the Seattle area, their preferred habitat is a Costco parking lot. They are thick in there. They nest in the little bushes around the edge in these lots. And I thought, how in the heck do they live there? There's cars whizzing out and in all the time. And I thought, we need to band a bunch of these blackbirds and see how they make it there. So I went really early one morning to Costco by my house to catch the birds and start tagging them. And I got there and there weren't any birds. The birds finally showed up at about 10 minutes of 10. Costco opens at 10 o'clock. And they were lining up literally right in front of the door, and they were the first ones in the store when the doors opened. They beat the customers into the store that day. So these birds are changing their behavior to start to take advantage of a warm, dry, churro-filled habitat once they get in there, and they love it. They're doing very well in doing that. And this is now we've seen red-winged blackbirds displaying inside of the stores, and this has been documented in Europe and many other places as well. So that's the first stage of evolution, a change in behavior, some kind of change in activity. Maybe it will become a culture or a genetically encoded trait through time. An example of one that is genetically changed now, a real change in the genotypes of species in our presence, is the junco, that adapter that I mentioned before. And what we see with juncos is that in just a few decades, the number of white feathers in the tail of male juncos has decreased in urban and suburban settings relative to wildland settings. And this is driven by female choice. So what is occurring here, two males are displaying as Jack's drawn here, and the male that has the most white in his tail is dominant and wins that territorial battle. And in a wilder setting, like up in the forests and the mountains here, the males that are able to command that territory are favored by females because they can exclude other males, and the females might get one or two breeding attempts in that year, and having a strong defense of the territory is important to their success. So females favor macho, white-tailed males up in the woods. But in the city, the males that spend all their time defending territory don't help out the females as much. And in the city, females, in my yard, a female junco could get off maybe even three or four, five broods of young. They might try to nest seven or eight times in the season. So they start very early and they go all the way through the summer. And there, females prefer males that will not spend all their time defending, but will care for some of the young. So when the female hatches the first brood of young and it fledges the nest, the male will take care. She can re-nest already quickly, get a second brood out. And those males are the ones that have less white in their tail. So by female choice, for different parental activities in the males, they've driven the phenotypes of these urban juncos to be much less white in their tail. And again, this happened, has been documented in the San Diego area in 20 years. Very rapid evolutionary change. And we now know that lots of traits in urban situations are changing very rapidly because we have such extreme pressure on the animals that live around us. Some changes are not genetic, but they're cultural. So song, for example, is learned by the son from their father in how they sing. And in urban areas, birds sing differently than in non-urban areas. So for example, this is a noisy minor. It's a bird in Australia that Jack's drawn. And these guys sing at higher pitch, louder, and more punctuated in their kind of a staccato rhythm around traffic. And that's because traffic noise is low frequency and drowns out a low frequency song. So you have to sing above the din of traffic to get your message across. And that's what these guys do. They even change very, very precisely, like on commuting days versus non-commuting days, on commuting hours versus non-commuting hours of the day, they will change the pitch at which they sing and how they sing. And the sons hear this and pick up this sort of trait, and this behavior changes very quickly because it can evolve within generations, basically. And then finally, I'll give you an example of where we've actually helped create a species. We all know cases where we've destroyed species, many, many, too many. But there's some cases where we've actually helped create one. An example of that is the Italian sparrow. And the Italian sparrow was formed by hybridization between the house sparrow and the Spanish sparrow that you see above there. The house sparrow you're familiar with, we have here, and they came into northern Italy about 5,000 years ago as the first people crossed over the Alps. And there were some years when the snow conditions were appropriate that people could pass through the Alps, and with them came house sparrows. They were already commensal with people at that time. And as they moved into Italy, there weren't very many house sparrows there, so they started interbreeding with the common bird, which was the Spanish sparrow at that time. And you can see they're similar, they're the same genus, a little different patterning around their face and their breast. But they interbred and they produced hybrids that look like this. And as there became more house sparrows, the house sparrows quit interbreeding with the Spanish sparrows and bred with one another. And as there became more hybrids, they started breeding with one another. And they basically isolated their gene pool, which was a combination of these, from both parents. And so today what we have is in northern Italy, house sparrows, throughout most of Italy, Italian sparrows, and in the south, Spanish sparrows. So a new species facilitated by our actions of moving house sparrows basically across the Alps. So finally, we have this great evolution in ecology. I also think there's great beauty in the suburban ecosystem. And an example of that for me is the Swainson's thrush nest. I love these nests. They're, in my part of the world, they're made out of moss, bright green moss that glows almost like an orb in the woods. And the neatest thing to me is that the females line these nests with the skeletonized leaves of alder. So they arrange these in there, and you can find these nests even at this time of the year. And if you see that lining, you know it's a Swainson's thrush. So I would encourage you to go out and try to find a Swainson's thrush nest in your neighborhood. I'm sure there are some right around here. But it's a cool thing, and it's the kind of thing you get excited about, even if you don't care about the ecology or the evolution, but it's just a really pretty natural work of art. All right, so we have these great things. How can we keep them in the landscape? I think we can each do a little bit that adds up to a lot that we can do for these animals. Any one of these things is pretty simple to do, and I'm sure you've heard of most of these things, but maybe by seeing them together, it'll help kind of organize some new thoughts in your head. So I'm going to talk about things we can do for habitat, things for the safety of the birds that are there around us, and then things to engender some wonder and care in young kids like we've got in the audience here that might allow you to be more interested in the animals around you. All right, so first, the easiest thing to do, if any of you have turf lawns, you can just get rid of them. Dig up some, plant some shrubs in them. It'll be great. It'll be increase the diversity of the area, and birds will love you for doing such a thing. Some of the evils of lawns are not so obvious as just the habitat. Even if you have a gas mower and fill it up, The amount of gas that's spilled every year in America, filling our mowers and weed whackers and things, equals the amount spilled in the Exxon Valdez. Every year, just a teaspoon or so per filling. So you could get an electric mower and be done with that, or you could do what I do, and that's quit mowing your lawn. It's technically called a freedom lawn, and it frees you from the tyranny of having to deal with your lawn all the time. And all kinds of cool things come up. All these flowers came up in my yard. They're probably not native, but the pollinators love them. There's lots of bumblebees in here. There's amphibians that are around there and juncos nesting in the grass. And at the end of the season, you can trim it up and make it a little neater. But if your neighbors give you any static, just tell them what a great job you're doing for pollinators and the tree frogs and things that are around. By increasing the diversity of native plants, of course, is great. They provide habitat for native insects that a lot of birds need. Just little patches and fringes around what lawn you may have can help a lot. Feeding the birds is important. What feeding the birds does not only provides great entertainment and exciting things like this varied thrush that sneaks in here to get some food, but it allows populations of birds that can adapt to us to build up in size. And a large population is a population that can evolve and adapt to our challenges. A small population doesn't, it goes extinct. So keeping some of these populations like these siskins, or here's the junco we were talking about, keeping them large and able to evolve things like change tail feathers or other behaviors that allow them to live with us can be helpful. Plus it's just a lot of fun to watch what goes on there. And it's, well, and this is going to be incredibly more important in the next 4 years. It helps our economy, right? So about 20% of citizens feed birds in the U.S. It's about the same in Australia and the United Kingdom. At least $4 billion a year here. We did a recent study in Seattle, $120 million a year there on bird food. I think most of that comes from my yard. And less in other places, but still substantial economic pressure that these animals provide. Providing not only food, but nesting situations. So you could put out nest boxes for bluebirds or swallows, that's great. Or you can do like what I did, and that is kill some trees on your property and let them stand as snags. Here we were just topping some of these trees, killing the top part. My friend Dan here has cut the top to look like a lightning strike. He's cutting slits in there for bats and creepers to use and drilling a hole now in a box basically that he's made in that dead tree that we hope swallows and other cavity nesters will use. The pileated woodpecker is our largest woodpecker in North America, and it was immediately in foraging on a lot of these snags we've created over the years. Having water, especially in dry climates like here, but even in a wet place like Seattle, a little bit of water is incredibly important for native wildlife. And brush piles, the Pacific wren that I told you about, the avoider. You can, if you have even just a small patch of forest in your control, brush piles provide the habitat that those Pacific wrens need. Wilson's warblers here would utilize thick understory with brush piles as well, plus all the amphibians and reptiles that utilize them. Even small brush piles are important refuges for salamanders. Keeping cities different from one another and places within cities different from one another is also important. That curve I initially showed you, the hump in the middle, that occurs because we have a lot of different habitats close together. If we don't do that when we subdivide places, then we lose that advantage. If we keep a lot of different habitats in the mix, we can increase the diversity there. And more importantly, from city to city, it's important that, for example, Aspen doesn't start looking like Tucson or Los Angeles, for heaven forbid, or Seattle. You know, to plant large coniferous trees and thick canopy here would do away with the unique species that utilize your more open sage and open aspen and conifer forests here. And what we want is for cities to be able to maintain that kind of natural backbone so that the native species that do occur with us can still occur there, rather than having the same homogenous group of animals in every city. Oh, bummer. There's a really great picture here. I will describe it for the TV. The great picture here is a spotted salamander crossing the road, and he's looking back, and there are two headlights coming right at him. That animal needs safe passageway across roads, as do lots of the big ungulates that you're familiar with here. But birds, not so much. They have a pretty easy time crossing barriers, but the animals that crawl have difficulty. So the salamander example is neat. It's from New Jersey. And spotted salamanders there move every season from places where they breed in ponds to other upland areas where they spend the winter. And this neighborhood, instead of installing pipes under the road like they have in some places for salamanders, they simply shut down the roads for a few nights every year and have a block party. And they celebrate the movement of the salamanders back and forth. They have a potluck, and everybody gets out and gets to experience the movement of these really cool animals. All right, so we've got habitat for these animals. How do we keep them safe? And survivorship is a key aspect of animals' ability to live around us, not only breed, but to live there. The first thing that we can do for birds is to keep cats inside. Cats are the number one killer of birds. It's been estimated most recently that between 2 and 4 billion birds per year in the United States alone are killed by cats. Most of these cats have names. They come and go from the house, and they eat a lot of birds while they're outside. Getting these cats inside increases their lifespan, reduces your vet bills, as I learned today, and reduces the spread of disease like toxoplasmosis that they also are involved with. So lots of good things for cats come about keeping them inside, and great things for birds and small mammals also occur by keeping them inside. If you can't keep them inside, you might try keeping them on a leash, because this is the hottest craze. I don't know if it's hit Aspen that much, but going hiking with your cat on a leash is now the big thing. It's also a great way to bird. You get the cat out there and you get all kinds of bird activity in response to that cat. See all kinds of cool things. This is a friend's cat. She trained it from a kitten to be on a leash. And now this cat, when she pulls out the leash, gets excited just like dogs do and gets ready to go for its walk. There's all kinds of catteries and other things you can do as well, but I think the leash is a good idea. Second biggest mortality source for birds are collisions with windows. Big windows like this are killers. About 500 million birds a year are killed in residential places in the United States alone by collision with windows. All of you have probably experienced this at your house. I know I had. And there's some simple things you can do. You can put ultraviolet reflective stickers on them. Not the black ones that block out your view, but ones that are kind of fuzzy as you look through, but birds see in the ultraviolet spectrum and we don't. So they see those and they avoid those windows. Or you could put netting in front, very fine netting that, again, you can look through without much obstruction. Birds would hit that and not collide with the window. Or just keeping feeders away from windows like this, or having plants in front of the windows so that the birds could land there before they come crashing through, because they just don't see the glass. You guys are going to buy some stickers? Oh, there is one? Oh, yeah. Yeah, these dark stickers work. I didn't see this one because it was dark, but there's one here. They work fine, but they block our view completely. So these other ones are a little easier on the eye, because I know you guys have awesome views here that you don't want to block out. So that's a good compromise. Assessing your lighting. Aspen is great for dark skies, and Carbondale was as well. That's not the case everywhere. And lights confuse a lot of animals, especially during migration. Birds will be confused and unable to travel their migratory routes. So making sure your lights are pointing down and not illuminating places that don't need to be lit helps birds and lots of other animals that need dark. Practicing tolerance. This is a difficult thing. You will be facing this challenge as wolves come back to Colorado. We have it with wolves already in Washington, but also coyotes. A lot of people love coyotes, and they're very important for the ecosystem by eating cats that might get out, and also by just keeping the balance out there. But a lot of people don't, and they're afraid of them or they fear them. Same thing with mountain lions, probably more so here than with wolves at this point. But understanding their role in the system, valuing that role, even if it's dangerous, even if it's a little bit scary to us or in a way that we feel is inhumane to the other animals, predators need to eat, and that's their job in the ecosystem. So valuing that is difficult for some, but it's critical for the overall stability and resilience of these systems. And then finally, trying to engage people with nature. I think one of the best ways to do this is to engage them with the nature that's right around them. And as I said in the beginning, I hope that translates into a stronger environmental ethic for other places. But to get this started, valuing pigeons and squirrels, non-native species even, that are in our cities that people can get close to and catch and chase and wonder about. Just the flight abilities of pigeons are amazing. They're flocking. We saw some flying together as a group out at the Rocky Bottom Ranch. And they're fabulous flyers. They're great navigators. And these are things that can instill wonder and interest in young people about how birds do that with that tiny brain, how they pull that off. And that might lead to this greater interest in animals in general and conservation in particular. So Aldo Leopold said these same things much better than I could. So I'll leave you with a quote that he had. He was speaking about agricultural settings in particular. And the point he made was that for us to really conserve and love a particular part of the land, and for him the land was everything, the physical land as well as the organisms on it, is that we had to see it as a community, not just a commodity. And certainly in suburban settings, it's a very important commodity that people have invested in. But it's also a very vibrant community, which I hope I've told you a little bit about tonight, some of the interactions there, some of the evolutionary changes that occur there. And as we start to see that and respect that, we can really value that bit of nature that we share, basically our life and our land with, and conserve it for the future. So with that, I would be glad to answer questions. If you want to learn more about the science that underpins the things I've told you tonight, you can go to our lab webpage there, or on Twitter, follow us and learn about new papers that are coming out and new things that we've discovered. So thank you very much for your attention and for having me here.
Hey, I have a question about that first species richness curve that you Sure. showed. So one of the things you were talking about following that was about keeping landscapes kind of heterogeneous, right? So those a mix of forest cover around the suburban landscapes.
Yeah.
One of the things we know about those more heterogeneous landscapes is that when you're chopping up little patches, you get degradation over time, right? So I was wondering how long you and your students, are those like PhD projects where you're looking at species richness for 5 years?
12.
12 or something. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but we looked at it in subdivisions that varied from 12 to 100 years. That's our oldest subdivisions basically in Seattle. I had another student who did that project. And there's some loss in those older subdivisions, but very little, frankly. It's kind of a dogma in conservation biology that fragmentation is bad, but it's not for some things. Fragmentation is good. It's called edge effect, heterogeneity, and that increases diversity. Leopold and a lot of the early wildlife scientists, that's what they taught. That was the conservation strategy of the day. Make edge, make things diverse so that you get more species diversity in an area. It favors a particular group of animals, which is what I tried to get across as well. It doesn't favor the avoiders, and those are the ones that degrade through time and you lose from that system. But the birds and other animals and plants that can handle that fragmentation and that changed environment there, you can actually pack a lot more of them in when you chop it up. As bad as that sounds from a conservation standpoint, it's kind of what does happen anyway in a suburban setting. And I'm glad to know that at least a lot of organisms can handle that. But it is a different group of them for sure.
One more quick one. Did you set up mist nets in Costco?
I never did in Costco. No, I didn't. But we certainly had them in lots of people's backyards and other places that they shouldn't have been. But yeah, Costco was out of bounds when the cars started coming in for sure.
Hi, thank you very much. I actually had two quick questions. The first one was tying into what you just talked about.
Okay.
And I was just wondering what your opinion is about increasing species diversity locally, but therefore contributing to kind of a novel ecosystem on a global global scale. Do you have an opinion about what, how the birds are reacting to that?
Yeah, it's a great question, and this is a concern that a lot of urban scientists have, and that is, while we might create local diversity, we're creating global homogeneity, okay? I don't think it's a big deal for birds, frankly. I've argued against it a couple of times. There are five birds that I pointed out that are particularly homogenized across the globe in cities. Pigeons, house sparrows, mallard, Canada goose, and starling. And those five species are basically found in cities everywhere. And they're native some places, like the goose and mallard here, and they're non-native in other places, like goose and mallard in Berlin. But that's a limited number of species. If you go, for example, I compared places like Ketchikan and Zihuatanejo, Mexico, and Seattle as kind of coastal, west coast places. You have a different cormorant in each place. You still have a cormorant, but it's a different species. So that's why I say it's important to make sure you keep the local flavor of the habitat there so that you can maintain those different species of cormorants in that particular case. If we have the same fishery, the same climate across all that area, we're gonna have one cormorant out of three, basically. So it's a possibility, but it's way down there, I think, in terms of things to worry about bird-wise. It may be much more the case plant-wise because we bring in so many plants and plant them, and we plant London plane trees in all the cities. You know, so again, trying to focus on having that native backbone of plants can help fight against that homogeneity. And it is definitely a concern. So it's a good question.
Thank you. Just similar, I know that some mammal species like mule deer and red fox have done really, really well with urbanization. Mm-hmm. And with the growing populations in urbanized areas, we've started to see a lot of genetic mutations and inbreeding and stuff like that within mammal species. And I was wondering if that is occurring in bird species, to your knowledge?
Not to my knowledge. We did one study on the genetics of song sparrows in the urban area, and there was some reduction in gene flow and therefore some inbreeding, not close breeding with close relatives, but coming to share similar genetics among song sparrows, that more so than you would expect by how far apart physically they were. And that's because some of their movements are constrained by the built environment. So that can certainly be the case. Again, there are going to be some populations of species or some species that do well with us because they can maintain large populations. Large populations don't have those genetic problems. Large populations can adapt through natural selection to the environment. And the species that can maintain those are going to do okay. Those that are going to be forced into small populations are going to have all kinds of bad problems for sure. Genetics one, but lots of other random loss of the males in the population, things like that could happen as well. So, yeah.
Have you studied the effect of spraying on the birds and insects?
Herbicides and insecticide spraying on them. We didn't study that specifically. It was built in. There's certainly more of that that happens in these suburbs than in other places. And I had one scientist who looked at heavy metal contamination just from mainly from traffic on, and we saw heavy metal contamination of some of the evergreen needles. But to translate that into bird losses, we didn't see any evidence of that. As I say, the reproduction was fine. It was what you'd expect. I didn't show you the survivorship curve, but in general, the birds, again, that do well with us, they have the exact same survivorship that you would expect for a bird of that size along us. So we didn't see any of the telltale signs like extreme mortality or deformities and things like that that you would expect with those sorts of challenges. But again, Seattle is a relatively new place. You know, and these are things that have been occurring there for 100 or maybe 150 years at the most. And so some of these extreme challenges and extreme effects on animals just may not be seen there yet also. It's good to know that we although they see pollution effects in other cities around the globe, they're kind of minor relative to agricultural settings. That's where those sorts of chemicals seem to have an even broader and stronger effect because they cover a larger proportion of the landscape.
I'm in the landscaping business, so I see a lot of what's going on in terms of the sprays, and have asked a lot of the people who do they say, yes, they do kill birds and they do kill insects.
Uh-huh.
And I've been tracking birds in my area for since the early 60s, and they're probably three quarters down from what they used to be.
Even of the same species that have been there the whole time. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, we haven't seen that yet, but it doesn't surprise me that in some situations... Huh. Mainly for weeds or mainly for insects?
Weeds.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's a great way to point out, you know, a lot of things that are unknown in these systems. So it may look good from the outset, but as you dig in, we can discover some of these other things. And
when you kill the insects.
Yeah, that's going to definitely, it's going to reduce the food supply for sure. But detecting it at a population level is often hard to do, because the populations are filled in by other birds that come in, and it points to the importance of long-term study, you know, like your observations, and the importance of big reserves outside of the city for some of these animals, so that they have places of refuge, and then they can come in and settle the city. They may not live there as long and do as well in some settings, but they have the ability to recolonize. And they're very good at doing that. Yeah.
Do the birds that fly into Costco know to fly out at night?
They do fly in and out all the time. And I don't, it doesn't appear that they stay in there, maybe a few. But you know, at the Denver airport, you may have seen birds that are in there. I think those are probably in there most of the time. And there are some that may start nesting and breeding in these situations. That's been documented in Europe now in different buildings. So yeah, Costco is a pretty big opening in and out, and pretty strong timing of the event. So I think they get in and out when they can.
What does Costco do about it?
Yeah, that's a great question. Costco put up all kinds of streamers. Now they've put netting around the trees right outside the door. None of it works. Birds are going in and out. And the guys that work there, I've talked with them, they think it's pretty humorous. But it's a battle now between, you know, the manager of the store and the birds. And my money's on the Brewers Blackbirds on this one.
All right, we're going to take one more question.
Yeah, they don't even need a card.
Yeah.
It's great.
Thank you so much for your talk.
Really, yeah.
I really appreciated that. I'd like to ask about your crow research.
Sure.
I have a long-standing debate with a friend who coincidentally goes to school at UW now.
Okay.
About how intelligence manifests itself in the non-human world. And it largely stems from your crow research, actually. I've heard that response to the caveman mask described as a learned behavior that is just kind of one crow that hasn't seen the caveman sees the crow that has seen the caveman attacking it and joins in as a social cue. I've also heard it described as something akin to an oral tradition. And I'm curious, if we may get philosophical here, about where we can draw that line and what your thoughts are on that. He and I have been bickering about this for about a year now.
Actually, it's a written tradition. We've discovered the crow scroll, and they write this out. They have drawings of the caveman. No, it's, I think, the first case. What most clearly we know, it's at least the first case where a bird that recognizes, either from something it had seen in the past or its personal experience, recognizes this danger, scolds. That's attractive to the other birds. They come in and they participate in that mob and scolding. And at that point, they're learning about that action and about that danger. Now, I have no evidence that they go back and talk offline about, hey, that caveman, he's a really bad guy. If you ever see him, make sure you scold and help us out. I don't think they do that. I think actually one of the clearest distinctions between how we think about the world and how animals think about the world is, for the most part, animals are in the here and now, and they're dealing with things that are present and foremost in their world, like a potential danger, a mate, food, whatever it is. And they deal with that. And we don't have any real evidence that they go back and discuss those things later. We do know that they dream, birds dream, and they rehash things they're learned during the day in their minds by activating the same parts of the brain that are active when they're doing things like learning about a caveman or learning a new song. So individually, they may rehearse and think about these things, but it's yet to be demonstrated that they have any discussions about that. Not to say that it doesn't occur, but we have not been able to document it yet for sure. So, but I think that's a big difference. We do this all the time, discuss the past, the future, and all these things. And I don't think animals do that as much, if at all. They really are focused on what's going on now. They're busy with that. Yeah.
All right, so that's it for the questions. Perhaps we could give Dr. Marzluff.
Well, everybody's heard about the bird. The bird, bird, bird. The bird's a winner. Well, the bird, bird, bird. The bird is a winner.